So when you're looking at your bone diagram, just really quick, you're going to see how the face has almost like little fissures. So they have what they call suture lines, right? You can see them on the, you know, on the frontal and the parietal and the temporal and the sphenoid. So they all have different kind of fissures or suture lines. Then the suture lines has the tendency to shift. And we know this through, you know, football players with concussions and that kind of thing. So with that being said, the muscle also has a tendency of, remember, shifting, because that fascia, that dense collagen, is also fixated to the bone, right? So we have a tendency to shift. This is why we're not exactly symmetrical. We're not born symmetrical. We only have a few that are, you know, born with that symmetry. But as we age, you tend to see one side of the face, you know, shifts a little bit differently than the other side of the face, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So when we're working with the Gua Sha, we want to keep in mind that the bone, as we age, it does deteriorate. So we want to make sure that we create that adhesion or that connection from muscle to bone as much as possible. Now, when we're looking at muscles, again, I think it's very important that you learn the muscle group, because with that muscle activity, you still want to go from insertion to origin.
Right.
So it is important how you actually flow, you know, do the lymphatic as far as the movement in order to lift that zygomatic area and smooth it all the way to its attachment, which is the temporal. So you want to, you know, again, the movements are very important with how you want to glide that stone over the face. So when we're doing it together today, it's going to be smooth movements. And again, it's insertion to origin, but sometimes with the muscle and how it's attached to the bone, it can be very tight. Sometimes you have to elongate the muscle so that it has more flexibility and more length to it to reduce that tension.
And we always go from insertion to origin, because then we'll pull the face down, correct?
Yes, you do go to insertion to origin, but there are going to be times when you're going to do the opposite, where you're actually going to lengthen the muscle because of tension. And this is only in certain regions, because again, when you're looking at where your suture lines are, as far as where your temporal joint is, and your your mandibular joint, your temporal and your mandibular joint, you're going to have that kind of tightness. This is where people grind their teeth, and they have. Very tight, either with braces or some type of, plate that they put in their mouth, whatever the case may be, it's going to have some kind of tightness. So this way we want to actually lengthen those fibers so that you can reduce a lot of that, that tightness.
Okay.
But that's just in your TMJ area. And you will also do it around the jawline area because of the bite.
Okay.
So again, this is where that joint is. If you look at your mandibular bone, your temporal mandibular joint, you have that where the jaw can get very disconnected, right? If you have some kind of trauma or damage to that area, you know, you've seen people or heard of people have dislocation, okay? So with that being said, with that mandibular bone, you're going to be able to work in an opposite direction. I want to kind of show you that. It helps to relax that muscle, helps to lengthen, so therefore there's not a lot of tightness.
Okay, so in my notes, insertion to origin, TMJ area and jaw area, you will go the opposite way because you need to elongate the muscle, correct?
Right, to reduce stress, right? To reduce stress or to reduce pain, basically. But with all the muscles, just to be clear, you are going to always go to insertion to origin. But an additional, you're going to treat all the face that way, but additionally, on the areas that are stressed or tight, because of trauma or because of their lifestyle or how they sleep and if they grind their teeth, if they use some type of device in their mouth to keep them from grinding their teeth. That's still a stress marker. So we have to kind of go the opposite way on our second pass. So now we have to think about the lymphatics. So we went from bone, where the sutures lines are, and we'll go through that as we go through the application. We go through the muscle groups, because that's on top of the bone. So we know that that shifts if there's trauma to the bone itself, okay? Or the suture lines will shift. So now we have to think about the lymphatics. Because as we work on muscle, we know that the byproduct of that muscle is going to be lactic acid. So we need to be able to flush that and reduce that and have it go through the right and left subclavian vein as it dumps through the body in order to eliminate. So we're having to also work on lymphatics. So this is very simultaneously, but I like to teach this way because we have to be conscious that the bone is very important because of all the different lines that the bone has, which is your suture lines. The muscles are very important because we want to shorten and strengthen the muscle, but then there's going to be times where you need to lengthen the muscle. And then we're going to be doing lymphatic drainage using the Gua Sha because that is going to help to eliminate a lot of CO2, waste byproduct, any kind of elimination that the cell needs to go through its own metabolic rate in order to push it through. So when we're working one side of the face at a time, it's going to be beneficial for us to work one side of the face at a time.
So one side of the face at a time, okay.
With this particular, now if you have two of these, you can work them together, okay?
Would you suggest me getting another one?
I do suggest you getting another one because with lymphatic drainage, it's all about the fluid movement where you're constantly moving each side of the face so that you can actually cause more of that drainage simultaneously. So it's very important if someone is swollen after plastic surgery, you do a gradual drainage to their skin. Too much drainage can end up actually making them very sick.
This Gua Sha tool, how long do we use it on the client? 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes?
No, you want to use it about 12 minutes to do okay. The full on Gua Sha because you need to do the full movement to one side of the face and the other side of the face. It is good that you have two tools. Actually, I do not, and I didn't think you would either. But I did bring one in for us just to go through the rhythm. But it is important to not overextend the lymph movement because remember, when you start moving lymph in the face and in the neck and it drains into the right and the thoracic duct, it does affect the entire body. So you want to make sure that they don't have severe heart conditions, that kind of thing. And be very conscious of their medical history.
Okay, I'm gonna write your contraindications.
Because I used to do lymph, body lymph on people that, had heart problems, and I had to be very careful because too much stimulation of lymph could actually affect the heart.
Okay, so contraindications, one would be heart problems.
Yeah, you want to be very careful. It's not like you can't do them, but you don't want to extend a large amount of time when, you don't want to do lymph drainage for 30 minutes on the face. You want to just keep it between the 12 to 15 minutes and call it a day.
Okay, so definitely 12 to 15 minutes for somebody that has heart problems.
Yes.
Or we can choose not to even do it if somebody has heart problems.
That's right.
So either way, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes. But it's going to be very good for acne. It's going to be very good for sun damaged people because their immunology is compromised. So you're trying to excite the lymphatic system and you're trying to get it to be less stressed in its environment and actually move it. So it's, you want to engage with the lymphatics. So it is very important. If you think about great exercises for lymphatic, you think about swimming. Swimming is a really great exercise for immunity of the body because you don't really have gravity. You know what I mean? It's lymphatics work best if you can kind of figure out what kind of anti-gravity, even though I know that's impossible, but what kind of movement can you make your body almost float, you know?
Okay. So. All right, back to contraindications before I write down the good things about it. Who else would I need to be concerned about for contraindications with Gua Sha?
You would have to be, you would need to ask them about different skin cancers like melanoma. That is a good one. Squamous cell carcinoma. That's also a good one that you need to know what their history is with skin cancers. Because melanomas, you know, even though they might be treated, you know, a doctor usually sees them every 2 to 3 months just to check on them, on their immunity, because, you know, different cancers can reappear in different parts of the body because the melanoma travels via the lymph, and so cancer cells can be broken off and they can go in different parts of the organ. So,
I'm going to do people that have had a history of squamous cell carcinoma. Did you hear what she said? Yeah, okay.
Okay. So with squamous cell carcinoma, it's a very surface skin cancer. So that also goes via the lymphatic system. So you just have to be careful. And those kind of people, you definitely want to get some kind of permission from their physician in order to perform lymphatics. Now there are lymphatic specialists, massage therapists that actually do lymphatic on cancer patients. For liability purposes, I just don't recommend it because you can't really, see, you know, how affected that person's going to be. And it depends on if they've gone through radiation or if they've gone through, you know, how many punch outs they've had from a dermatologist or a plastic surgeon to try to make sure the borders are clear. You know, there it's a big deal, especially with melanomas.
Okay.
Yes, cancer, different skin cancers. I mean, you don't want to do somebody with, sunburn is fine. It's fine because they've been compromised. So you want to engage in trying to manipulate that skin so that you can, you know, have less stress on the skin.
Okay. And I'm just going old school. If somebody comes in here with a bad sunburn, I'm not going to do a facial.
Well, right. But you can do, use our Vital Recovery on them and do a little bit of Gua Sha. But if it's like sunburn to the point that it hurts, you know, then of course you're not going to. But if it's a sunburn that they've already gone through that sensation, you know, that where the pain, you know, it's not as uncomfortable as it was when they had it 3 days ago, then you can go ahead and use some good Gua Sha on them as well. Yeah.
So are those really just only the contraindications?
Yeah, that's the only ones I can think of. It's just cancer and then, of course, heart disease. It just depends. If you're working with somebody that is typically, they hold a lot of water, they take heart medications plus diuretics in order to make sure that they stay without a lot of fluid in their body. So those are the only two people that I really, or two conditions that I really, red flag.
Okay. All right. Now it's good for acne.
It is very good for acne.
Okay. After psoriasis, what else did you say?
You can work on people that have psoriasis, rosacea, someone that is, sun damage, photo damage, because they're already immunity compromised, and you can perform Gua Sha on them. Anyone that has, oily acne, sun damage, sensitivities like rosacea or seborrheic dermatitis, anyone that is, eczema, because I worked in the UK a little bit, and that was very plentiful over there. So,
excuse me, I have a question.
Uh-huh. I mainly do it for functionality of the skin. When you're lightening freckles or any kind of pigmentation like that, you have to think about it on two ways. The product that you're using needs to be a therapeutic action, so that because it is enhancing the functionality of the skin, so therefore the permeability of the product is going to be enhanced. That's one factor, so that can create a lightening and a brightening effect to the skin, because you're enhancing more oxygen, you're enhancing more vascular, you're increasing the vascularity of the skin, you're increasing protein, so the cellular mitosis and all of that good stuff. So you're increasing the total function of the skin. So that by itself can be lightening and brightening to the skin. But to say that it is a pigment, it gets rid of pigment, I haven't seen that, okay? But it depends on the product that you use with the Gua Sha and what is going to be the other aspects of your treatment in order to focus on pigmentation.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Back to acne and rosacea. Can I work with a Gua Sha on any, all the acne grades, like 1, 2, 3, it doesn't matter?
Does not matter. Mm-mm.
Okay, so I can do that with no matter, what grade the rosacea is and the acne is.
And remember, this is going to be very vital after extractions, okay? So when you're doing extractions, if you want to do like LED light after your extractions, that's perfectly okay. But after LED light, go ahead and finish it up with Gua Sha, because it's going to really help to eliminate a lot of that congestion, that cellular congestion that is there, and it's going to help to move it out.
Okay, great.
Remember, this is like feeding the skin at the grocery store. You're getting your best vegetables, your best protein, your best carbs, your best fats. You're feeding the skin what it needs in order to survive. You want to feed the cell so it can remove all the other good stuff, okay? All the other bad stuff. But I want to reiterate one more time, and because I'm so passionate, I'm so enthusiastic about it. But this is how I like to line it up, okay? So bone is very important, because we lose bone density as we age. And it's no different than, the bone in the face. We lose that density. So it is very important that we try to capitalize on, really manipulating the muscle to bone response, because this is what is going to create that adhering connection. And this is what we're trying to do as far as not only manipulation of muscle, but also to create and to rid the muscle of any kind of lactic acid or any other type of buildup that needs to be processed and moved out of the body through the lymphatic system, okay? So remember that your lymphatic system is how it takes the waste and you are moving it out to the dump, okay? It's moving it away. So this is very important when you're doing any type of treatment on anyone that you're trying to make a positive skin change. So even with microdermabrasion, when you do a microdermabrasion, you are actually increasing the receptivity of the skin, but the microdermabrasion is accelerating the blood supply, which is very good, which means that it's also accelerating the lymphatic system.
Okay.
Because remember, the lymphatic system moves by muscle, by arteries or capillaries or what they call arterioles, and it also moves by just breath. So as we breathe, the diaphragm moves it, and muscle also moves it. This is why it's important to exercise, like I say.
I just want to get this, so when my client asks me, well, what is the difference of the regular facial massage that you've been doing on me compared to this? You know, and I want to be able to really give an intelligent answer, which you are providing me, so that's why I'm asking questions.
Oh, no, I love it. This is an intensity of actually creating a balance to how the functionality of the skin works. It creates a deeper response to how it needs to work in order for you to improve your immunity and your overall cellular regeneration, which means everything in your body, okay? It affects everything. When we start using Gua Sha for the face, we're also affecting all the other parts of the body. So it's a beautiful thing because we're creating that stimulation as a whole. So it's very holistic because we're not working on just, even though we're working on one part of the body, it affects the whole body. So when you start with your, stretch your chin for me, thank you. When you start, you want to empty, you want to gradually build, move upward with your fluid drainage. So I always like to try to empty the neck first because that's where the majority of the lymph nodes are. They're very dense in the neck area and behind the ear. So I like to go ahead and start with the behind the ear and just use these movements to open up the ducts and do my pumping sensation. And again, I'm doing this over the oxygen products because we're, you know, really encouraging oxygenation, vascularity of the skin, increasing cellular response. And just really open this up. And then once you have this open, you can also do the pectoral draining in the arm, underneath the arm, the axillary. Once I open the neck up, then I can start with my forehead. Go in between, go over the brows, and begin my movement of performing 3 times with each pass. In the same area before transitioning to the other area. And the fluid, it's a fluid movement. You want to make sure that you really go behind the ear and move forward to the clavicle so that you're really working with the lymph nodes that are underneath the submandibular area. And try to keep that nice connection going so that you can create each pass 3 times. Each pass 3 times. Make sure you go underneath the eye. And don't forget to pump underneath the eye as you slide and move. And before you smooth to the clavicle. So each movement 3 times. Side of the nose, to the cheekbone, behind the ear, to the clavicle, and pump 3 times. Now we're going to start at the upper lip. I'm going to go to the middle of the ear, in front of the ear, behind the ear, and pump to the clavicle. To the corner of the mouth, to the bottom of the ear, in front of the ear, behind the ear, and pump out. Each movement is three times. Each movement is three times. Again, we're going to start at the bottom of the lip, pushing out, front of the ear, the back of the ear, pump towards the clavicle. Bottom of the lip, moving towards the end of the ear, behind the ear, pump towards the clavicle. When you get to the chin, we're going to do the actual top of the chin. We're going to use the V cut of the stone. Go towards the ear, behind the ear, and pump to the clavicle. Again, top of the chin, to the ear. And you want to have continuous movement if at all possible, no disconnection. I'm going to flip it over because I want to go under the chin. So the larger part is under the chin to the ear and moving downward towards the clavicle. Again, underneath the chin. And manipulate towards the clavicle. So once you are finished with this side of the face, you want to do the neck area. So the neck area, you want to push down and pump at the clavicle. Do that three times by just going down. And you want to start at the throat area, where it's in the submental part of the chin, and just push down to the clavicle. Try to have them stretch their neck so it's nice and smooth as you transition to the clavicle and pump. You're going to do that three times. And then you're going to move over to the middle part underneath the jawline. Pump out. I'm going to do that three times. And go to the outer portion next to the ear. And then I'm going to go from the outside in, from the outside behind the ear, and then to the clavicle. Okay?